she had a whole bunch of these. And I said, I want to do something with a piano. So we traded, and she gave me a piano roll of, what was it? It's some blues. Fats Domino. What was the most famous blues song? Anyway, it was one of those. So you can hardly see it, but all of these little things there are the little punch holes from that. And I gold leafed them. So all of them are little gold leafed. You can't really see them from the slide. So on the side, there's the blues, and on the other side is Benevento, so it's not Benevento blues. And they're husband and wife. So it was kind of an homage to my really dear friends. And I used it again and again and again, and there's more of the Benevento chant like that. And so I went through a period that lasted quite a few years of making things that are like manuscripts. Remember, palimpsest. Palimpsest is, you know what a palimpsest is? Okay, let's say you have a piece of parchment that was music that was written down in the 11th century, and the parchment's really hard to do. It's a lambskin. So it's expensive. So 300 years later, somebody in a notary's office needs something to write on, a file folder, and he scrapes off all this fabulous music and writes something else on top. But you can still see it with certain ways of, you know, like infrared photography, and there's even more sophisticated. Well, that's a palimpsest. That's something that can be viewed through something else. So these are all basically, you know, with that idea. And I was also borrowing text because of codes from the internet. So I would go onto the internet and find languages from South India, from all over the world, and download them into my font file. So on my computer, I have hundreds of fonts from different languages. And then, let's say I write something in English. Now I lay me down to sleep. And then put it into, it's in Times whatever. What if I change it to this East Indian font? Bingo, suddenly it's a code. It's a substitution code. And if you knew what I was up to, you could read it. But you can't read it because it was English, but now it's English with codes. And I was doing I was invited to a conference in Berlin. Carmen was there too. Carmen Colangelo was there, and I was here, and I was showing all this stuff. And this woman, obviously an Indian woman, said, I know that, but that doesn't say anything. That was her language. But it didn't say anything because it was really in English, but it was a substitution, a simple substitution code. So that's what those things are. And then, actually, a friend of mine sent me a book on handwriting that he found in the Oxford Library. And it was all kinds of handwriting of different people, but it also had things from an exercise book that children would do in learning. And that's what that is. And I, for some reason, I got interested in just all the different languages. By the way, there's over 5,000 languages in the world, and we're losing languages at the rate of, I used to know the figure, maybe 10 a day, disappearing forever from the world. And that was interesting to me, but I went and I found, I call this doubles because the word two I found in hundreds of languages, and that's what this is. So you can barely read it. But it's the word two. And then I had some where I had one, two, three, four, five. All of that translated into all kinds of different languages. It's really interesting. And it was fun to do the research because, you know, some of them were really interesting. There were some ones that were really from, you know, very simple languages. What do they call the languages that aren't really languages? I remember one was Tupala, Tripala, Forbala, you know, things like that, made up languages. I'm missing the word, but that's what this is about. And then, suddenly, there's a break. I've been doing these manuscript pieces, these colored, rather, I would say, lush prints And Meredith's heard this story so many times, she'll be bored, but I had this piece of Mylar, which is, you know, you've seen Mylar, it's plastic, it's gone. And I thought, you know, I bet I could do rubbings from some of these solar plates that have all this stuff on them. And I just started horsing around. I thought maybe it'd be a landscape, who knows what. But it turned into a face, a big face, this big, not this big. He's George. And I'm drawing, and Meredith comes down from upstairs. She's teaching upstairs, and I'm in the print room. And I said, Meredith, I have just done the strangest drawing I've ever done in my life. I don't know where this is going, but I love it. And I haven't done anything since. So this is not the first one I ever did. This is Drago. Now, when I started these things, because the first one was done without any idea where it was going to go, I thought it would be a landscape, but it didn't. So my way of working now is I start with a blank slate, no idea, try to not have any ideas, except that it's going to be a portrait. That's the only idea. And I don't know who it's going to be. I don't even know if it's going to be a human. And I just start drawing. And the people form themselves at some point. There's a magic kind of tipping point. Sometimes it's when I add an eye or a pupil or a nose or something. Suddenly, a personality seems to develop. And then I think I know where I'm going, and it gets easier. So after I'd done about 30 of these things, I was asked to be in a show, and they wanted an artist statement. I called it another artist statement. I don't want to write one. So I thought, I've done that, been there. And I had thought originally, see the time. I'm okay. I was asked to show some work in the psychology department of the UT Health Science Center. And they were inviting artists to have shows. I thought, you know, these things would be probably interesting in an area that's devoted to psychology, because they have this kind of edgy quality. And so I thought, wouldn't it be interesting if I put these things together and then put a little book and ask people to write their impressions about what they think this is all about. But I didn't do it. But then, when I needed to write the artist's thing, I thought, I'll do it. I'll write something about the print. And it wasn't this print. It was one of the other ones. Actually, one that's in the show, Tom, Dick, and Harry. And that one was my first narrative that I wrote. I just wrote it, bam, like that, three sentences. And I don't think I even changed it. And I thought, this is really fun. I'm not a writer, but this is really interesting. So I had by that time 30 of them, and over the next weeks and months, little by little, I came up with narratives for all the characters that I had drawn. And then from then on, every character has a narrative. But the drawings come first, the narrative comes later, because, except for one, and it's on the entryway, you'll see it, it's the Pigeon Sisters. That one was done ahead of time, and then I had to draw the picture. But I don't think that's a good idea, because, as I say, I want to start with a blank slate. I don't want any ideas when I start, because then I can draw anything, as long as it's a portrait. So this is Drago, and to me, I had a friend once named Drago. He was from Yugoslavia, and I thought, that's a great name. That's kind of sinister, because he looks sinister. And there he is, and I made this ridiculous thing about who knows what that's about, and there's something going on in Eastern Europe, and that's not really a mashup, but I thought, well, a mashup, you know, it's what. And this is Christoph. My daughter Rebecca found a little agenda on the street, not in Florence, but some other place. It was a date book, a little thing. She picked it up, nobody's name in it, and it wasn't really a date book. It was a date book that was used for prayers. And there were all these beautiful prayers written in her handwriting, just like the guy from Genesis of Jesus, you know? Handwriting. And I scanned it, and I've been using it ever since. And that's what's on his face. All those little things. I didn't write those. The person who had that little book. So that is the basis of the narrative. So some of these narratives have a little basis in reality, and some are just, who knows where they come from. They just dropped down out of the sky. But this one didn't. I just found out that my little grandson, Ian, they have this in their house, and it started to scare him. You know, before, he loved it in the beginning. He loved Archibald, and now he's decided he scares him a little bit. He'll get used to it. My daughter, Rebecca, runs our school in Florence, and she wanted to do a show. We have a beautiful gallery there that we show contemporary art. And she asked me to have a show of all of the pieces. By that time, I had done 85 pieces. But we couldn't do, you see how much space they take up. So I just printed them on a little printer. And so these are reproductions. And then we framed them all, went to IKEA and bought the frames, and had this show. And then, of course, people had, they had all the narratives, and they would walk around and look at it. So this is the entire oeuvre of samplings. And I call them samplings for an obvious reason. There's little pieces of, well, I didn't tell you the whole part, did I? I left out where all the marks come from. Let's go back. They come from money. They come from portraits on money from all over the world. And I have a really good collection, and people borrow, they loan them to me, and I scan. I'm only interested in the portraits, and only the ones that have beautiful engravings on them. I scan them. I put them on the computer, I work them over to Photoshop, and then I make solar plates out of them, and then I put them underneath the mylar and I do rubbings. These are frottage. I draw marks without rubbing once in a while, but that's how all of these marks all came from some bill someplace. Might have been Mao Tse-tung's jacket. He's been very good to me. The Queen of England's been very good to me. Particularly good is Ataturk. But lots of Brazilian money is just beautiful. And I only take little pieces. So the eyes, that's nobody's eye. That's a construction of an eye. And I may have made the eye from somebody's chin or their nose and then put a pupil in and it becomes an eye. So that's why I call them samplings. They're little samplings, like musical samplings, little pieces of things rearranged to form something new. After doing 85 or more of these black and white ones that are printed in editions and with Jean Poulet, I wanted to return to color. And I thought, I can't just keep doing the same. So I started by taking a few of the black and white ones that I'd already done and thought, I'll just print mini editions of what they call edition varié, variants, 4, 5, 6. You can't repeat watercolor. And make a little group and then move on. So that's what this is. And because I wanted to see what the images would do to my color, so the color would be based on what I see and what I think the print is about. This is a dangerous character. And he really looks like some Renaissance guy with his hat. I did about 5 of these, I think. I have no idea who H.N. is, really. But I like this idea of somebody paging through and finding this guy's name, Rodolfo, written in script, in elegant script and gold leaf. Because I use gold leaf in my prints. This is Hans. This is in the show. This is kind of, this by the way is white, but it's not really. Those things are gold leafed. It's just that I wasn't good enough as a photographer when I did this to be able to. Gold is really hard. Gold leaf is hard to photograph. So I looked at this guy, and he looked like he was in power. And so I made him in power, as you can see from that. But this is really kind of an homage to 16th century English portraiture. Or think of Holbein, who wasn't English, but worked in England. Think of his portrait of Henry VIII. And then you'll see it in your art history class, for sure. We just saw it in Rome, actually, one of the two copies of the Palazzo Barberini. It's fabulous painting. And the English would traditionally put a date, put the man's name, maybe who did it, or whatever. And this is an homage. I do a lot of homage pieces. Tipping my hat to things that I love. I did this as just a black and white, and then I added color and added the codes. So these are all my codes from all those scrambled languages. And he looked kind of vaguely Arabic. And I found out that in the 7th century, there was a guy named Abu Yusuf somebody, who was the one who broke the codes, the substitution codes, the simple codes, by knowing that if you have a phrase and this keeps repeating X number of times, it's probably an E because E is the one that's most used, and then A, and that's how he broke the code. He figured it out in 700. So that's who he is. Now, I don't know who the agency is, but who knows? This is kind of an oddball. I couldn't come with, I felt this needed no color. So it does have color. It's all gray. And actually, the one this is in the show, that part that's black, I actually gold leafed in some of them. The one in the show is gold leafed. I like to have fun. So cricket and grab, the two, I looked up the most famous geneticists in the world. There's five or six of them. One of them is named, not cricket, but cricket or something like that. And one of them is named Berg. So I just took Berg and threw it backwards. This is an homage. What is it an homage to? Kyoei Prince from Japan, of which we have a small collection. And so I drew the eye, and then I drew this strange mouth, and it reminded me of the warrior prints that are so common in Japanese woodcuts, where, you know, they're very ferocious. And so I thought, I'm going to make a new Kyoei print. That's what I did. This required an extra plate, because I needed to have something that would be like the sky in landscapes, as you almost always see it go from light to dark. This is the last one. Anybody know the folk song? I have a lot of them. Stewball. Anybody know that song? Peter, Paul, and Mary did it way back. Well, this is kind of scrambled Stewball. And this is our new studio in San Antonio we just built. It's absolutely a wonderful place. And this is our studio in Italy, in our little village, and there she is working. And this is what it looks like from the outside. When I'm bored or I can't figure out anything, all I do is just walk outside. That's it. I hope somebody has a question. Oh, come on.
I will ask the first one.
No.
Students have to have that. But you know, when you say you don't know where that stuff comes from, it comes from you. So it's really interesting in that psychology department to have people tell you what they think of those.
I worried about the fact that if I did them myself, it would limit what people could see. Originally, I thought I wanted these to be open so people could make their own stories. So that's one of the reasons I thought maybe I should write these magazines, but it was too much fun. So what I'm writing is called flash fiction. Have I heard that name? Flash fiction is very short, it's like poetry, and there's parameters which you can set. I set them, 2 to 3 sentences. Never more than 4 sentences, sometimes only 2. If there's a third one, I'd like it to be a zinger. I would like to be Woody Allen. So, yeah, I don't know where the narratives come from. I really don't. I don't worry about it. I just know that there have been times when I have a really interesting image, and I think, I'm just going to go up and sit with my computer in bed and wait.